All right, well, everyone, we certainly want to welcome you for joining us for our second webinar series on growing herbs. My name is Baron Rogers. I'm the coordinator for the UMES Extension Small Farm Program. I will be serving as your facilitator for this session. Before we get things started, I want to cover over some housekeeping items for you. First, we want to make sure that if you have any questions for our presenter, please make sure that you use the Q&A section there. If you see your little options there at the bottom. So under the Q&A section, if you can kind of pose your questions for the presenter. And what we'll do is after about 25 minutes into her presentation, we will take a break to entertain some of those questions that you have. And so if you can put that in the Q&A, that would be great. Now, as far as the chat box, you can also include maybe other types of questions or needs, comments that may not be directed to the presenter, but just anything that you want to share or maybe kind of share where you're tying in from, or any comments, we'll feel free to put that information in the chat section, okay? So now we're going to go ahead and introduce to you our featured speaker, Henriette Den Ouden. She serves as our specialty herbs consultant here at UMES with the Small Farm Program. She is a master tea blender with a degree in herbalism from the Maryland University of Integrative Health. She is also co-owner of Habanera Farm, where she has been growing and drying herbs for over 15 years. So I think it's safe to say that she does know a little something about herbs, and we certainly look forward to her coming on. So at this time, I'll go ahead and turn it over to Henriette, as she will take you on a virtual tour of our special herb garden located there at the Extension Education and Demonstration Farm in Princess Anne. Henriette?
Welcome here at the University of Maryland Eastern Shore. We are standing in the front of our demonstration herb garden. We will walk over it and go over all the plants that are growing here. My name is Henriette Den Ouden, and I'm really excited to do this class because when I started 15 years ago with my own herb farm, we did not get any help. We didn't really know what we were doing, so we lost a couple of years by figuring it out. And I hope that by just listening to this and probably following up with some more questions, you get support to get started in the right way. And I'll start talking a little bit about the general side of growing herbs. You can see here we have perfect lines with the herbs, and everything is very well maintained. This is because it's a show garden, it's a demonstration garden. Your own farm will probably never look like this, but that doesn't really matter. You see we have irrigation, the blue big line, and then we have sight lines, dripping system over the rows. Every dripping line can be turned on and off because not all the plants need the same amount of water. Then you'll see we have, you don't really see that very well here, but we have straw in between the rows. The rows have been made as a hill because we had the tool here. You don't necessarily have to do that. If you don't have the tool, it's harder to do. Then right away after we made it, we put the straw in between so we wouldn't get too many weeds. Then we had people pull out the weeds that came up still, but that wasn't too hard. The one thing you don't see here is a shady area. We simply haven't built a shady area. I hope to do that in the future because some herbs just don't like the sun. And we have some plants that should be having more shade, but we just don't have it. So that's a little bit in general what you wanna know before you start. The soil is very hard, clay, loam. At the moment, it's really hard. This was just grass. We rototilled it, planted a cover crop, and we then rototilled it again to get rid of the cover crop, and then we made the hills for the planting areas. That's it for the generic part. So we start with the first line that we have here, which is the elderberry. The elderberry were planted this spring. Elderberry is extremely popular for the berries and for the flowers as well. When you order them, you get sticks like this. You get them in like March. You plant them in the soil up till here, and then they will come out. So when you plant them in the soil, you need to make sure that you have one not sticking out. And this was a little one that I made at home. I just put it in the soil and it grows. You can barely kill it, basically. Talking about killing it, deer are extremely good at killing this plant. They will eat the leaves, they will rub their horns against it, and it's not going to be pleasant for the grower. So if you want to decide to grow elderberry, please make sure you have no deer and put a fence around it, which add a lot of money to your original starting cost. But it's worth it, because if you don't, it's not going to work. The elderberry, we have planted two kinds of elderberry. This is the Bob Gordon, and that is the Idlewood there in the back. They were planted every 3 feet. We planted them, and it was an extremely dry period. We didn't water them enough, so some of them didn't make it. Now, what I would do is plant them every 6 feet, and then after 1 year, plant them in the middle of the two. So when the first one starts growing too old to really carry lots of wood, you have your second one and maybe your third one. So you have an ongoing equal level of harvest. That's about it. There is enough companies that sell starters.
Question. Is this, Henriette, is this a native elderberry plant or the different varieties that you have?
Yeah, we decided to not to use the native, but use those specially raised one, because of the value of the berry. So the berry is a little bit bigger and has a little bit more of the sweetness that you're looking for. So you could do the exact same thing with native elderberries out of your area. My fear is a little bit, and that's based on my own experience, that probably the birds eat more of the seeds than they will eat from those non-native ones. These are also really good for this area. Now, one thing I should say in general here, we are at the eastern shore of Maryland, which has a very long warm season up till mid-October, beginning of November. It can still really be nice, like 60, 70 degrees. And that is totally different than when you're up north in Western Maryland, where the season is a little shorter. So that's what you need to be aware of. The other thing is we are at sea level. I mean, I think we are like 4 feet above, and it's totally flat here. So we choose not to grow plants that normally grow at 300 feet along a creek in the hills, because it's so totally different native area, and it probably will grow, but it doesn't get the right values. And if you grow herbs, you want to sell them to the supplement industry, you really have to have the right circumstances, because the company will check the quality of your herbs. So you have to find a way to either replace the native area or only grow it in the native area. Let's move on to this ground cover that we have over there. That is bitter melon. And we actually have an example here, two that are already picked. They are, can I get them? They are the weirdest things, I think. And there's a lot of them hidden in between the leaves. They are bitter melon. They are not a melon, they are squash. They are called bitter because they are extremely bitter. They originate from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, that area, and where it's part of the national food. The reason we are growing them here is it's extremely healthy for your blood circulation and for people with diabetes. So the industry actually uses this to make either a juice or a capsule for people, especially with pre-diabetes, and it's pretty effective. You can also eat it. You can probably sell it on the market if you have enough people from that area. If you are in an area where there are not that many non-American native people, non-American people, I mean, you and you will have a hard time to sell it because it's just very bitter.
So what part is the part that they use to process either capsules or drinks? Is it the outer flesh or
I don't have a knife on me. It's both. You cut it open. It's just like a squash. There's the seeds in the middle. You can easily pull them out. And then you use the skin and the flesh. And the middle part you throw away. If you let them sit too long, they get fascinating bright red seeds that are not used for anything as far as I know. Yeah, there's two in there. So you can grow them flat like we do, or you can put them build some racks that they can hang down. Then it's probably a little bit easier to find them. The problem with doing that, if there is a lot of wind, the whole thing might collapse. And we are in that area with a lot of wind. So, all right, let's move on to our next one, which is cotton. This is brown cotton. There's white cotton and brown cotton. These big plants are grown, see, and they get bigger. They get at least 6 feet high. Those huge plants are grown by us only for the bark of the root. So you have this giant plant, you dig up the root, and then you cut off the bark. So you don't get much weight per plant out of this. Now, it's a plant that's traditionally used in Africa and by the African Americans in the US. They use the bark of the root for as a help in with the birth and as a something to stimulate an abortion. Currently, it's still used for a variety of female challenges. Other reason to plant this plant, I don't know if you see a flower. They have really gorgeous flowers. They're pink and then they turn white. Here's some pink left. Oops. And when the white flowers get fertilized, they change into purple. And when the cotton starts growing, you get those light brown cotton things on it. So it's a cool plant with a story, which is nice if you at your herb garden do more than just growing herbs, but you have tourists coming by. You have something to tell them that is just an interesting fact. Most people have never ever seen growing corn these days. I mean, growing cotton. Can we move on to the burdock? I realize when I was preparing this that this is a really weird combination of plants. We have something really tropical directly out of India and that area. We have cotton that originally comes from from Africa, and then it's sitting in between the local elder and this burdock that doesn't even grow here because it's too warm normally. This is from upstate New York more, or from my native country, the Netherlands. Now burdock is, we grow it for the root, and I cut this off without the right tools, so it broke. The root is very white. See, it's really a light color. The root is very sweet. You can eat it raw, and it's very good for your digestive system. It's a prebiotic. It creates the right probiotics in your system. It's very popular with people that are extremely aware of what they eat. Nobody really is allergic to it. It's very safe. You do it in soups, or you eat it raw, or you saute it. It's a good herb If you want to sell something in the winter and in early spring, you leave it in, you can harvest it throughout the whole winter, and then sell it on a market, on a farmer's market, if you have people in your area that have a interest in it.
How would they sell that? Would they just sell the whole plant?
No, they sell. You do a better job at digging them up, and you wait so it's larger. I estimate that this goes on till like this far. So you only sell the root. If you have chickens, you feed this to your chickens. Maybe other animals too, I don't know. The one thing very, very important to realize, if you don't take them out by the next spring, they will go in seed. And you get these horrible seeds that stick to absolutely everything. And they have little needles, so they are really painful. You don't wanna deal with it. Some people use the seeds. The seeds are very hard to harvest. They sit in here. You have to drive over it with a car to break them. It's problematic, but some people want to do it. So the burdock is a nice crop if you want. If you have a farmer's market in the fall and in the winter, you can sell this. All right, so we move on to the spilanthus. So here we are in another area. This is actually originally from Argentina. So now we are in Latin America. This is a very interesting plant. There are two varieties. There's one with just the yellow flowers, and there's one with yellow flowers with a yellow and a brown bottom. They look like, they even more than these, look like candies. It's not a talking subject if you have tourists coming, because it right away attracts children. It's also known as toothache plant. The part that you harvest is basically the top with some flowers. So this is all. You cannot use the older flowers. People will not want to buy this from you. And it can be dried or pulverized and made into a medicine for toothache or your immune system. If you want to plant these, we didn't really start about the starting. Everything that's growing here, we've planted, other than the elderberries, we've planted by seeds. We've done experiments with doing them in flats and then planting them as the little plugs, or we direct seed them. The burdock, we have all direct seeded. You don't want to be bothered with replanting them. They don't need to be replanted. The cotton, we're all seeded in a heated greenhouse because it's a tropical. And you plant the seeds at the moment that the soybeans are going in the ground here in this area. That's how we remember you have to plant the cotton. It's a similar seasonal product. The bitter melon at the same time, because it's a tropical plant, they don't like the cold. The spilanthus you can either do in flats first, or you can direct seed them if you wait long enough that the soil is heated up. And we did half direct seed, half planted, and there's absolutely no difference in the result. So it's really up to you. My reasoning, if you do direct seeds, and we can see that better at the next plant, if you direct seed, you have to thin them out because you get too many plants. So also, if you have direct seed, you are going to deal with a lot of weeds if the herbs don't grow quick enough. So if you have fast growing plants, you can do it. If they're slow growing, you prefer to plant them in flats and then plant them out as small plugs. Let's go over to the next one, the holy basil. This actually is really one of my favorites. I love the smell of it. It's very nice. I cannot transfer that, sadly enough, but it's very nice. And this kind in particular attracts a lot of bees. Of course, when you tape, there's no bee. I have been harvesting these. There are different kinds of holy basil. It's the temperate that grows the best. It's not that valuable as a tea, I think. The other thing is when you start drying them, if you dry them, they are very, very, it's a huge volume, but then when they start getting drier, they really, really slink, and it's not all that much anymore. There's at least one little creature. the holy basil Rama that we have, the next, and then we have all the way at the end, we have the Krishna, which is really dark, dark purple, which is very nice. The Krishna tastes a little more spicy than the Rama, and this one is a little bit less of taste. You can sell this, you can sell it as a fresh herb. People like to make their own teas and people add it to salads, or they make, you can use it as regular basil. It's just much, much healthier than that.
But what's the difference? Why do they call this holy basil as opposed to just regular basil? What's the...
good question. It's holy. It's the original name is Tulsi. And Tulsi, in the Hindu belief, Tulsi is the goddess of health. After she passed away, she reincarnated in this plant. And that's what makes it holy. And the Hindi have a ritual with this plant. They often have one of the plants in front of their home. And that brings me up on another point. The leaves are used, but also the roots. They make prayer beads of the roots. So you probably, the roots actually get relatively big. There will be people in that community that will have an interest in that to make them, which is cool. Now you have two things. I brought this one with me. I plant the seeds of most of the holy basil in a flat like this. This is, of course, pretty sad. I never use them. Holy basil, when you plant the seeds, they are very, very vulnerable for what is called a fungus gnat, which is an invisible little insect that sits in the soil and that will eat your tiny little holy basil plants. One day you come back in your greenhouse and they're gone. It's very dramatic. And it is because your soil was just a little bit too wet. The other hand, if you have your soil too dry, they won't come. They will not emerge. So it's a very fine balance between too much water and too little water. And to give that a better natural balance, I prefer to use a flat instead of the flat with the little plugs in it. And there is a better result in the percentage that comes up if you do it like that. The temperate holy basil is very easy to grow, but the Rama and the Krishna is much harder. So it's more important to do it the right way. You grow them in a greenhouse or you grow them in a regular hoop house with a heating pad. You will not be able to grow them without heat. Same for the cotton, same for the bitter melon.
There's
quite a lot of companies that sell good quality seeds. If you go for the medicinal herbs, you want to stick to companies that sell medicinal herbs, that advertises medicinal herbs. And a good rule is any company that does not give the Latin name, don't work with them. We have everywhere, we write down the Latin name because some plants, there are plants that have the same American name, but they're totally different plants. So you wanna check that, and then you wanna check if they, what's their variety. If they only sell one holy basil and they don't really mention what kind of it is, don't work with them. And basically you can say don't work with them at all, because if they don't really are very good, very well prepared with this one, what makes them well prepared in other ones? The other thing that's a good one that you can do is, if it's a smaller company, give them a call and talk with them and ask them what is your target group. Some startups are not really ready yet to have all the Latin names, and they still have very good quality seeds. But big companies that mainly sell vegetables and flowers, they're as a rule not the ones to go to for medicinal herbs. You're good for edible herbs. And then things like the cotton is just very few people that sell them. Let's move on. We have the St. John's wort. So now we have jumped from India back to the US. St. John's wort is a native plant in this area and more north. And it's a very popular, it has been for a long time a very popular plant, used as an antidepressant. It's not that popular anymore, but it's still an important plant. It is the part that's harvested. Let me show you. So out of the whole plant, you basically only use the top with the flowers. And this is not an annual, this is a perennial plant. It will have, hopefully it will have more flowers next year. And you can check if you have a good quality by smashing or pressing the herb. And you need to get a little, which we don't. You need to get a little red juice on your fingers when you do that. You can see it a little bit, but not really much. It's probably too late in the season. But you see from the whole plant, you only use the top. Now, normally in the spring, this is totally covered with yellow flowers, and that's when you harvest it. It's around the end of June, beginning of July, and hopefully that will be the case next year. This is not the native one. This is a cultivar, Topaz. The native one is my experience, is hard to grow. It's very, I would call it stubborn. You plant the seeds here, they come up there, they find their own way, and it's not the same way as you want them to be. So this is a little bit more organized. You can kind of see how much harvest you will have, where if you do the native, it's questionable. It's an experiment. Other herb growers have been very excited with this kind, so I suppose it's good. I'm disappointed it didn't get red, but the red is that normally comes out is the oil, and the oil is the valid part that you actually use, plus a little bit of the leaves.
Okay, everyone. Well, at this time, we're going to go ahead and entertain some questions from you. And Henriette will, as you see, she's joined us, so she'll be able to answer some of these questions. So I guess, Henriette, if you like, would you like me to just go through the questions either in the chat or the question and answer, or do you see them there in front of you? I don't hear you, Henriette. Just bear with us just a moment while we get her. We're going to bring Henriette from the farm and bring her back in the office building. There we go.
All right, you can hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I don't hear, there was a couple of questions on the elderberry. The variety we grow is the Bob Gordon and the, oh my goodness, I just knew it. I'm sorry, I will have to email that to you. Idlewood, I think that's what it is. Other question is why we needed a fence. We needed a fence because we are in an area with really a lot of deer. And although we originally were told deer don't like elderberry, deer actually absolutely love elderberry. Not only the leaves, but also the stems that are being used by the bucks to sharpen their rack, their horns. So you have to invest, if you want to seriously grow elderberries, you have to invest really a lot of money in the fencing. If you live in an area where there are a lot of deer, if you're lucky, you don't need to do that.
if you have just a few in your herb garden, like 3 or 4 trees, you can take the risk and just see what happens. Another question we had was the yellow flower is Pilanthus. And I don't know if there were any other questions because I'm at another computer here. I'm sorry for that. Can we go to the first slide?
And while you're going to that slide, I can see the questions from here, Henriette. So I have a question here. It says, will you say again the name of the St. John's wort cultivar?
Yes, it's Topaz.
Okay.
T-O-P-A-Z, I believe. And I believe there are 2 varieties that are cultivars, and we just picked the Topaz.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it's the first year. We haven't really had any harvest because it's a perennial. It's very often with perennials, your harvest the first year is much less. And in our case, the harvest was absolutely nothing. And I just hope and pray that the next year will do better.
Thanks, Henriette. And the second part of that question, which you may have touched on, I was looking at another a question coming in. Where did you originally source, I guess, the plants from? Did you cover that?
I think the St. John's wort came from Richter's in Canada. A little bit about it. We normally try not to buy from far away from where we are, but this year we did because it's still on the East Coast and it's still, the climate is really totally different than where we are at, but basically we couldn't find that same thing at any other company. Now in general, since we talk about seeding, for coming year, I fear that the seeds will be sold out really quick. We're going to lose several seed companies, sadly enough, and my heart goes out to them. They are in California or in Oregon. So I wonder what's going to happen there. So I advise everybody to save your seed, which you should always do, but this year really, and buy, order your seed on time. Don't wait till March because you're not going to get them anymore. Not the quality you're looking for.
Okay, good. Another question that's come in, what are your top 5 herbs that you recommend for beginners to grow?
Oh goodness, that really depends where you are. If you are where we are, in lower level land, very easy is a lemon balm. The holy basil is easy if you have the plants started. The seeding is challenging. If you're new to it, you probably should just experiment with it and maybe ask an experienced farmer who grows eggplants, which is a very similar growing process, if he can please grow you 2 or 3 flats of holy basil. I have really good experience with that. The people that do that are much better than I was in the beginning. Holy basil, lemon balm, you can do mint, it's gonna be a little wild. Goodness, it really depends where you are. If you have a place for an elder, it's fantastic to have. It's a very popular berry at the moment. Other plants that are popular are, if you can do it, lavender or rosemary, you would wanna buy the plants. Other plant I grew this year here at the farm is horehound, which is a very nice plant for lung issues. So it's a good time for this year. Easy to grow, it's in the mint family. The sweet Annie is easy. The bitter melon was extremely easy. So now talking about the bitter melon, I need to make a correction. I don't know what was going on with me when I was taping this. We did plant the bitter melon directly and we also planted the cotton directly because of the warm area where we are, we don't have to seed them in a greenhouse first. Just wanna make sure that I mention it. I don't know why I didn't mention that in the first place. Shall we go to the PowerPoint?
Yes, we have less than 1 minute. I'll let me ask one more question. You can and I guess this is a follow-up. One question has come in. Elderberry is a native to Florida. Is that the same that you grow?
A native to Florida. I think it's a different variety. We grow the black elderberry. There's different kind of, there's a Canadian elderberry. There's a Nigra, that's a black elderberry. You want to grow the dark colored elderberries. And I do not know if they grow in Florida, but I think it'll be easy. Just ask a grower there. I would think it's useful as well. The varieties sometimes have very little difference. There's a huge difference, and the one you can use and the other you cannot use. I believe as long as the fruit is dark red to almost black, you're safe. If they don't turn almost black and stay red, it's less valuable.
Okay, thank you, Henriette. We see some more questions coming in, so if your question was not answered right just yet, just hang on. Henriette's going to touch on some more things, and we'll make sure we'll get around to some of these other questions for the second half or towards the end. So thank you, and Henriette, we'll go ahead and proceed with the second part.
Baron, can you hear me?
I can.
Testing, okay. So we're gonna switch out again. We have Henriette's computer going. Okay, you ready?
I'm ready.
We can switch, you can go back home.
Oh my goodness.
They can hear you.
All right, now we're gonna go back. I'm gonna mute myself, give me 1 minute.
Well, I'm sorry, Henriette, I don't know what happened, but I don't hear you now all of a sudden. Hit the unmute for Suzanne's computer.
There you go. Yes. This overview is just to put some reality in the economics of growing herbs. I did a couple of experiments, and the one on the right, the fresh rama that we harvested 33 pounds of fresh rama. We ended up with 1.9 pounds of dried herb. So that is almost 6% of the original weight. I want you to be aware of these numbers, because sometimes a buyer is going to pay you based on the dried weight and not on the fresh weight. And you sometimes, or mostly, you do not know exactly when the buyer dries it, how much they actually end up with. So it's important to be aware of this. Now, the reason of this loss in the fresh rama is you only use, or I only use, the leaves, because we mainly make teas of it. Very, very little of the stems is coming in there. You probably can use some of the stems, but I don't consider it a very good medicine, and it has less taste. So we don't do that. Now, the other overview, you see the difference per plant that you have. Lemon balm, we harvested 11 feet of lemon balm, and we got, over a season, you probably get 5 pounds out of that. Now, if you go to the holy basil, the same 11 feet, you get probably over a whole year, maybe 600 grams. It's like 1 to 1.5 pounds. The other interesting thing, it was amazing, partly amazing. We planted the holy basil 1 foot apart, and we planted them 1.5 foot apart. And we actually had more harvest from the 1.5 foot than we had from the the monk food, which is basically because it has more room to grow. It will feel better. It will go to seed at a later level, and it will just grow more leaves, and that's what you're after. Now, this is not a final result. This will be still in the season. We're still harvesting it. So those numbers might change, and I'll make sure that we let you guys know what really was the annual effect of this. The Krishna is a beautiful plant that has really cool dark purple leaves when you dry it. Sadly enough, you really have much less harvest than from the Rama. And actually, I didn't put down the numbers for the temperate. The temperate was not much better than the Rama, despite the fact that it looks like a giant plant. It's also harder to dry. For some reason, it turns black. But that's a whole different subject, the drying part. Can we get next slide? Oh, I need to do it. Doesn't work. Oh.
No.
There you go. The seeding, just a little bit about the seeding. As I said earlier, when you are inexperienced in seeding, you're new into growing, you haven't really grown tomatoes before, do not bet on everything coming up that you planned. It's a learning process for some of the herbs. And it's really, if you really want to have a harvest, it's really easier to just ask somebody else and pay them for it and get your plugs when you want them. You can direct seeds. You can, if you do direct seed, you have to be aware if you have slow growing plants like skullcap, for instance, you want to weed in between, and that is very time consuming. It's also kind of difficult if you do not know how your herb is going to look. That's the reason why I very often prefer to grow the plants in a flat. The other things are pretty self-explanatory. The soil, you really want to have good seeding or soil. You can make it yourself or you can buy it. Do not try to take some soil from your land and put it in a flat and then grow it in there, thinking that that's a natural environment. It's going to be too hard for the herbs to get out of it. Let's go to the next. Growing, yeah, I did mention we have rototilled land, and then we add here at the university, we add mushroom compost. My own farm, we make our own compost. You want to add some compost to keep the soil airy and to make it a little more fertile in a very natural way. We use the ground cover. We use paper ground cover that we roll out when we plant the plugs or when we plant the larger seeds. The paper ground cover stays okay up till harvest time. It's very easy to use. And another reason to have a ground cover is when you don't and it rains, you get the soil on your plants. So it's easier to work with. Always count on a totally dry year. Always put irrigation in. This year we did, and I think I used it twice, but you never know. It could as well have been a terrible dry August. If you grow for production, make sure you have a setup that's easy to deal. Don't go for a cool layout with round circles or stars, or just go straight so you can put your drip lines in and it's easy to work with.
So we finished the questions.
And we go back. All right, we go back to the video part.
All right, this giant is Sweet Annie. This normally doesn't get this. I've never seen this enormous. It's, I don't know why that is. Sweet Annie has a very, it's not even sweet, but it has a very specific smell that obviously we cannot take. Sweet Annie is used for malaria, that's the most well-known. And sweet, somebody actually won the Nobel Prize for chemics with Sweet Annie. What's used is basically just this, these little parts. And it's mainly only used by the supplement industry and herbalists. You won't be able to sell this at the farmer's market. This is a good example of the importance of the right moment of picking an herb. You pick this now, you see how it has little flowers in it? Probably already seeds. No, it's still little flowers. When you say you want to dry this, when you dry this, the flowers continue to set seeds in a sped up speed because of the heat that you bring to it. And then when you're done drying it, you don't have the flowers anymore, you have the seeds. So you want to harvest it before they really start setting seeds. This is still just in time. Now I harvested, you can see it, I cut off one of the plants last week, and about half of another plant. And then as a result, when I dried it, I had 3 pounds of the herb. So you do get, for giant plants like that, you get 3 pounds out, say two plants. It's, I don't know, it's not really a lot for the size of the plants. You will only grow this. You should only grow this if you have somebody that wants it. You're not gonna plant this because there's not many people that really like it. Now let's move on to this popular plant here that you should be able to sell, Echinacea, coneflower. This is the purpurea. There's also an angustifolia, which is doesn't grow very well in this wet Eastern Shore climate. It does better at a higher elevation too. This is absolutely gorgeous in the spring. It's still kind of cool with all the seeds. It's one big pink line. It's beautiful. The part that's being used is the roots, mainly. Now also the leaves can be used and the flowers can be used. If you use the flower, you want to dry them, you have to cut them because they're so big. In this case, you harvest the roots after 3 growing seasons. So it's not I plant this and in the fall I harvest it. This you have to plan ahead of time. After 3 years, you get very fine little roots, totally different than the burdock that we had. It's very thin. You get like, it's just like a ball with those roots. When you wash them, it's very labor intensive to just get all the soil out of it. We use a cement mill. It just turns it out with water so all the dirt gets out. Before you buy this, before you start massively planting this, make sure you have the right kind. You need to test it. If you have a leaf and you just take a little bite of it, it needs to tingle in your mouth. This one does tingle in your mouth. The tingling indicates the quality of the plant. If you have one that doesn't do that, you're not at the highest level of your plant. If you want to sell it to the supplement industry, they're not going to want it because it's not strong enough. So you want to really talk with the person where you buy the seed to make sure it's the medicinal value and not the one that's made to look nice, which this is the original native ones. If you harvest the roots, you can split them up and plant them again, so you can harvest again in the year following that. So when you started after 3 years, you have an ongoing harvest basically if you maintain it well. Sometimes the you could probably sell it at a farmer's market if you have some amateur herbalists in your area, just families that want to make their own medication. They will be looking for this one. Native American and European. This is actually original, the European one. Now we are in China, Baikal skullcap, which is it's just a gorgeous color. And it's the end of the season, so it has a lot of seeds. This is, we had a little one that I dug up. Where is it? It's probably still there. You use the roots. It's a perennial. You harvest the roots in the second season, and you see the plants get really very wide. You want to plant them at least 1.5 feet apart. That's what we did here. If you have standing water in your soil, they will not survive the winter. Only let them overwinter if you have a good drainage system in your water, in your soil. If you're able to keep them for a second year, obviously the roots are much, much bigger. Don't keep them for a third year because then they get too woody. So you want to be, you want to pick them. You want to dig them up in the fall this year. Now, one thing in general I didn't mention before, today I harvested a little bit of that burdock and I really had to struggle with my regular shovel. It really didn't do well. We are using, when we harvested, we use what you call a broad fork, which is a tool with long stainless steel needles on it, basically. I don't know how to call it. You put them in the soil and you hang on it and it brings up all the soil so that the roots get loose. That's the safest way to not to damage them. It's labor intensive if you have a soil like this. If you have more sandy soil, it's much easier. If you have more sandy soil, you probably will also get better, or not better, but you get more roots. Now, one thing, if you start these from seeds, I plant them in a regular flat like this, but you want to have the one that is relatively deep. Same for the echinacea. Because you're developing the root, you want to develop the root from the minute you plant your seeds. They need to have space to go down, because they already develop like this much root before you even see anything coming up above the soil. And then if the roots are coming out here, right away plant them into a deeper pot. It's very important. That's your gain. That's the strength of your plant. You plant them in a shallow one and your roots start spreading out, you will have forever spreading out roots. So that's really important to do. This one, you could plant directly, but it's very slow growing in the beginning, so you're gonna have trouble with the weeds.
Yeah, this produces a nice, pretty flower. Is there any particular uses for the flowers?
The flowers are just amazingly beautiful, and you can put them in your salad, but there's not really any official use for it. The leaves also have a nice taste. You can add them to your salad. Yeah, it's nice. You have a very valuable crop used by Chinese medicine, and in the summer it looks really pretty. But then we planted some of the zinnias just to make the area a little more flowerful. In the back we should probably walk to that. So this is the astragalus. Astragalus is a very popular plant used for your immune system, and it's the same as with the echinacea. You don't take the first year, you don't take the second year, you take the third year roots. The plant's gorgeous. It's in the pea family. Those little things are little peas. It gets really pretty pink flowers. I really like it. It's very easy to grow if you have the right soil. And right soil means good drainage and not too much water. So in this case, the Baikal skull cap and the astragalus are on one line because we turn off the water supply when we are watering. And with all the rain that we've had, it's still doing very well. We had some damage. The leaves fell off. It wasn't too bad. We never really understood why it did that, but it's coming back. So some of those herbs go through a temporary, something isn't right with them, but they recover themselves. You don't have to totally get into panic if you have some whiteflies or some aphids, because a lot of those herbs have the natural capacity to recover. You really see a good example. This is so nice, light green. And this in the beginning almost totally died off, and then it came back. You can see a little bit of the flowers here. So it's the roots So the same thing, you plant the seeds in deeper pots.
Yeah, I noticed once you open up a pot, you get these like little...
You get little peas.
Little peas.
Yeah.
Are they edible?
I don't know. Try it. And you see in between here, with the wheat, you see a lavender plant. Because honestly, we had given up on the astragalus because they came back so late. So we planted some lavender. There's a lavender here. There's a lavender underneath there. Lavender doesn't really grow very well here. It's too wet. But those seem to be doing fantastic. That's another thing. There are, you're reading books, so there are like rules on things, on plants. Where do we grow them? How do we grow them? And then you plant them in a little different circumstances and they still do fine. The question though is, are they really the same quality as when they are in the area where they should be? Now for the lavender, we were just going to plant a lavender because we love the flower. So not, we won't advise anybody on a low area this wet to grow lavender because it's just not growing very well. Let's move to the lemon balm. This is lemon balm, and lemon balm is a mint in the mint. Oops, is in the mint family, and you can see that it has a square stem. But it tastes it's totally lemony the way it tastes. This is a very nice if you have a bunch of kids that are running around too much. This is a very calming herb for children. Now to grow it, you can direct seed it or you can seed it in plugs first. Doesn't really matter. Both. We have direct seeded and planted on different distances and thinned out more and less. You can't even see all the signs that are underneath that. So we need to do a little better job. Now, one thing, if you plant your plants like here in a plug, you see how we planted them very close to each other. If you start harvesting them, you cut them off, it's very easy to take one whole set together and then you come with your pruner and you cut them off. If you have them all spread out everywhere, it's much harder to get that bundle together. That's why I like to plant them as one little plant instead of planting the seeds. Now, lemon balm is a perennial. My experience is that lemon balm will disappear. It will be fine for 1 year, maybe for a second year. So we're going to leave it, but I doubt if it will be still a good quality the third year. Other thing, just as with the sweet Annie, you want to cut this before it gets in flower. And this is not yet in flower. We can still cut this. If you wait longer, the leaves are going to be too hard. That's not a good thing neither. So this is much better than these. So when you start growing your herbs and you have somebody that's going to buy them, you want to discuss with that company or that person, when do you want me to harvest them? Because if you harvest them and the leaves are too hard, they might not want them. So they need to be clear. You need to really get an answer. I want them to be harvested after this many weeks or when the leaves are like that. Or you go over and you show them, is this right to harvest them? The companies that buy your products, they can just totally say, no, I don't want it anymore. It's very important to be very, very clear when you start your initial connection. This whole lemon balm, I harvested like 10 feet and I got out 2 pounds of dried lemon balm. So this is 40 feet. So this would be a total of 8 pounds. This whole thing is 8 pounds of lemon balm. So you need to have a lot of if you really want to have a lot of harvest. It will be more because I planted that, I harvested that early. It's probably 12 pounds that you get off here. Later, I have some more data that we can share. Okay, we are at the ashwagandha. Ashwagandha is at the moment an extremely popular plant. It gives people energy. That's just one of the many, many positive things that it does. The part that's used is the roots, the rhizomes. You plant them in the spring as a seed in a deep pot, just like the echinacea. And the roots require kind of a sandy soil that is not too wet in order to grow really deep. It's important for this, especially for the ashwagandha, that you don't water it too much. If you water it too much, the roots are going to be lazy. They're going to hang out on the surface because there's enough water. If you don't water them, they have to fight and they will go deeper, which means for you, you get more and better quality root in your plant. So one of the things we have here is we turn off the watering system because it really shouldn't get too much water. It's not a difficult plant to grow. It's a very slow starter in the beginning, and it's a very vulnerable plant in the beginning. You want to really have a ground cover because the weeds will overgrow it in the first month. And it also is known to have like white fly or aphids. And if you just spray it with some neem oil on a regular basis, you keep it under control. It's not a serious threat. And just like what I said before, it will grow out of it. You just don't want to have it in your garden or in your farm because the aphids and the whiteflies might move to other plants that probably cannot beat it. Now the roots, they're pretty big and they go deep, and you really want to use that broad fork to harvest them. If you have huge amount of ashwagandha or huge amount of other root plants, you want to start thinking about a mechanical way and look into like a potato harvester, see what you can do with that. You see the seeds, they're interesting. They are bright, they're bright orange, bright red. They're not ready yet. And one seed pot has like a lot of little seeds. So the seeds itself are used, I think, in Ayurvedic medicine, not normally in Western medicine. If you want, you can sell the seeds pretty easily because you get so much of it. It's your potential customer is basically, again, people with an Indian or a Pakistani background who use it in soups, people with a totally alternative lifestyle that want to be healthy. They use it as food, or they powder it and use it into their smoothies. Big, larger companies will want it, and herbalists will also need it for their own harvest. It's a specific group, though. If you just grow it, you wanna know why you're growing it, and you wanna have an idea of selling it before you start really growing it. On the other hand, because after the beginning, it's relatively easy. You don't have to pay it any attention anymore. So it's not like it's going to cost a lot of labor if you can't sell it. And if you grow it, it's good for you as a farmer because it gives you a little more stamina to go on through the season. Ashwagandha, now we go back to Middle America. Those are the edible herbs, the culinary herbs. This is papalo. And in the back, we have picha. This was part of an experiment because we wanted to do an ethnic food festival, which clearly has been canceled this time. It's a Middle America herb that mostly tastes like cilantro. And it's a very specific taste. There's people that like it, there's people that don't like it. It's a very easy growing plant. The only thing I realized, if you put this in a windy area like this is, you're going to lose the plants. They're going to fall over. They're going to break off. So it's better if you have a little more protection. Again, only grow this if you have a Hispanic community right next at your farmer's market. You will not sell this to 99 of the 100 Americans.
Okay, Henriette, now it's time to get back to some of our questions. We will start with some of those that we've missed. So hopefully if you're still on, you'll get a chance to hear some of your questions being answered. And Henriette, I don't know if you see it directly in front of you, but if not, I can go ahead and just read the question and you can go ahead and respond.
Yeah, I did answer several questions. I didn't answer all of them.
Great.
The one that I remember that I really wanted to answer, there's two questions on rusts on St. John's Wort and rust on marshmallow, and they mentioned something else. The St. John's Wort that we're growing, I don't know what's going to happen next year. We did not have rust this year, but it's only the first year. The St. John's Wort that we grow at my own farm has some minor rust problems. It's never been an issue. It's always on the lower parts of the plant. We never lost it. We never lost a plant to rust that we didn't want to lose. I mean, you never want to lose them, but sometimes it just doesn't matter because you have so much. The one thing to do against the rust is, in general, against pests, is to plant the plants on a certain distance so there can be an air movement in between. Fungi don't like air movement, and rust, it probably limits the growth of rust. It won't prevent it because the rust comes from the, it gets in the plant. Any plant with a rose in the rose family that you're growing in a relatively moist area might get rust. Sometimes it gets transferred from other trees into your herbs. We are growing, we're not really growing hawthorn. We attempted to grow hawthorn and it didn't work because we get a rust in it. If you have one plant with rust, it will move to other plants. We had the source of the rust that we had was actually acrimonia that started and then it moved to other plants. So you want to know which one starts. And questions like rust or bacterial insect issues, if you're just starting and you have a question, you can always ask the extension services in your area, can you please help me? They probably don't know much about herbs, these kind of herbs, but they will know a lot about these kind of pests because it's not limited to herbs. In general, I find that the herbs really recover or grow out of it. I have never had an issue with it, and we have never had a real issue with it here at the UMES farm without really doing much about it other than once in a while spray with neem. That was the one question I remember. I don't remember any other questions. So, Baron? Did we lose everybody?
No, I'm sorry. I was just on mute. My apologies.
Okay.
So I'll go back to the Q&A section and just kind of pick up those remaining questions that are still unanswered. I think one of them, and I don't know if this is directed to you. I assume it was directed to you directly, Henriette. It says, does this grower sell these herbs to markets? And if so, how many? And so I would assume maybe the question is, you know, from your farm, are there any herbs, I guess, that you grow and you sell to markets?
Yeah, we at the university, we do not sell them. It's really just for demonstration. We give it away to people that need it. At my farm, I process everything into teas. It's actually a really good question. The profit margin on herbs is only really profitable if you grow large amounts, I think, and if you have set up your farm really efficient. The way of doing that is use a cover crop, prevent too many weeds to go in between the plants, and make sure that you, if you get some kind of pest, make sure that you notice it right in the beginning. At my farm, everything gets sold as teas. Other people create their own tinctures, their own medicines. And then, of course, there are farms that really sell their herbs per pound to a wide variety of customers. They are mostly larger farms. Unless you have, unless you're located in an area where there are a lot of herbalists and you have a direct connection with them, then you can start growing on demand. So they let you know, this is what I would do at least, they let you know in the beginning of the growing season, like this year, like in January, they let you know, I will need 10 pounds of lemon balm in July. So you can prepare for it. Personally, I think growing without really knowing who's going to use it, who's going to buy it, is risky. Again, unless you live like in North Carolina and you have massive amounts of herbalists surrounding you, then you're cool. Where we are here on the Eastern Shore, or if you're in Delaware, there are not enough people that will just buy your dried herbs. Baron, there was another question on the drying. I did answer that. Drying, it's important. There's a difference in drying if you have a relatively dry environment like Vermont. The drying can be relatively simple. You heat it up and you let air blow through, and then you suck out the moist air. If you are living where we are, where the moisture can hit like 90% at night, it's more complex. You wanna have a more you need to have a different kind of drying. If you grow elderberries and you don't have that many, you can use the little tabletop dryers. Same for like chamomile. If you get two or three of those dryers, then you can dry quite a lot. One thing to keep in mind, some states like Maryland, they have regulations surrounding the drying. So before you start doing this, you want to ask your state, what are your requirements? Or you don't ask, and then you risk that they will come to your farm and start limiting you. Talk about regulations. If you just set up your farm, it's a good idea to look into the USDA regulations like the GAP and the FSMA. And I'm not going to talk about it, but just be aware that those regulations exist, and set up your farm from day one in a way that you can pass these tests. You can get a certification when you need it. You probably don't need it when you're smaller, but when you start growing, you definitely will need to look into these things. And it's better to start out in the right way. Same with organic. If you want to be organic certified, start out like you are already applying, even if you're not, but just be ready for it. So it's much easier to adjust when you start than to adjust when you have been in business for 5 years. Baron, I think we should do one more question, and I'm still sorry I can't see them.
Okay. And I'm not sure if you answered this particular question. I didn't see it checked off, but one question has come in. It says, we've been really struggling with rust on marshmallow and powdery mildew with, I believe that's Monardus. Wondering if you have any tips for dealing with those issues.
Yeah, that's what I just answered. And I really think air movement is important, and keeping track what plants in the rose family you have that have the rust already. The Monarda, when we grow it, we have to be very careful, not for rust, but for fungi. And you can prevent fungi by having more room in between the plants. Make sure there is air movement.
Can you do one more before we conclude?
One more. I can still talk for one more.
Okay. All right. It says, do you sell anything to homeopathic medicine companies?
We don't, but if there is a homeopathic company that needs herbs, yeah, they can come. And again, let the farmer and or us know ahead of time so we can grow it. I do get questions like allergy season starts and it's May, June, and people call and they want nettle. And then I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't have any nettle left, or I plan to use all my nettle in the tea. So if you want to sell to companies, start talking with them now so you have, you're ready for it in January.
Okay.
Unless somebody needs just a little bit, you know, or you can still plant it. That's a different case. But if you really want to do this for a business, take the gamble out of it, because it's not working. It's still a business.
Great. Well, I think, Henriette, we touched on all the questions. And again, Henriette, myself, and Ms. Street, we will go through these questions. And if there's anything that has not been answered, you'll go back and answer those questions. And is there any information that they can, if they have any further questions, can they contact you, Henriette? Will you be okay providing?
Yeah, if they start thinking a little bit more, or like in a month time they have a question, yes, they can always reach out to me, and I'm here to help.
Great. Well, everyone, we certainly want to thank you for taking time out of your morning to spend with us, to join in on this session. If you did register for this session, we do have your, email address. And so you will be in our network, as it were. And so whenever we have any future events, and particularly those on herbs or any subject matter that's relating to herbs, we will be sure to send you any information on upcoming events that we will be having in the coming future. So I don't have anything else to add, Henriette. Anything you want to add in closing?
Yeah, I just learned that this whole presentation will be mailed to all the participants.
Great.
Other than that, thank you for listening. I hope it was helpful. And again, like what I said in the beginning, we started without much help. And I really think it's important that the United States starts growing their own herbs. So as much as I can contribute to that, I'm absolutely planning on doing that. So any question, just let us know. And besides that, everybody stay safe, be careful. And I hope the people in California that are still joining us and on the West Coast will be safe too. And thank you again.
Thanks, Henriette. Well, this concludes our session.